Eggs, Beans and Crumpets by P.G. Wodehouse. Read by Jonathan Cecil. 1. All's Well with Bingo. A bean and a crumpet were in the smoking room of the Drones Club having a quick one before lunch, when an egg, who'd been seated at the writing table in the corner, rose and approached them. "How many R's in intolerable?" he asked. 2, said the crumpet. "Why?" "I am writing a strong letter to the committee," explained the egg, drawing their attention to the intolerable... "Great Scott!" he cried, breaking off. "There he goes again!" A spasm contorted his face. Outside in the passage, a fresh young voice had burst into a gay song with a good deal of vo-de-o-de-o about it. The bean cocked an attentive ear as it died away in the direction of the dining room. "Who is this linnet?" he inquired. "Bingo Little, blast him. He's always singing nowadays. That's what I'm writing my strong letter to the committee about, the intolerable nuisance of this incessant heartiness of his. Because it isn't only his singing, he slaps backs. Only yesterday he came sneaking up behind me in the bar and sloshed me between the shoulder blades, saying, 'Aha,' as he did so. Might have choked me. How many S's in incessant?" 3, said the crumpet. "Thanks," said the egg. He returned to the writing table. The bean seemed perplexed. "Odd," he said, "very odd. How do you account for young Bingo carrying on like this?" "Just joie de vivre." "But he's married. Didn't he marry some female novelist or other?" "That's right. Rosie M. Banks, authoress of Only a Factory Girl, Mervyn Keane Clubman, 'Twas Once in May, and other works. You see her name everywhere. I understand she makes a packet with the pen."
"I didn't know married men had any joie de vivre."
"Not many, of course, but Bingo's union has been an exceptionally happy one. He and the other half of the sketch have hit it off from the start like a couple of lovebirds."
"Well, he oughtn't to slap backs about it."
"You don't know the inside facts. Bingo is no mere wanton backslapper. What's made him that way at the moment is the fact that he recently had a most merciful escape. There was within a toucher of being very serious trouble in the home."
"But you said they were like a couple of lovebirds."
"Quite. But even with lovebirds, circumstances can arise which will cause the female lovebird to get above herself and start throwing her weight about. If Mrs. Bingo had got on Bingo, what at one time it appeared inevitable that she must get on him, it would have kept her in conversation for the remainder of their married lives. She's a sweet little thing, one of the best, but women are women, and I think there can be no doubt that she would have continued to make passing allusions to the affair right up to the golden wedding day. The way Bingo looks at it is that he's escaped the fate that is worse than death, and I'm inclined to agree with him." The thing started one morning when Bingo returned to the love nest for a bite of lunch after taking the Pekingese for a saunter. He was in the hall trying to balance an umbrella on the tip of his nose, his habit at leisure, and Mrs. Bingo came out of her study with a wrinkled brow and a couple of spots of ink on her chin. "Oh, there you are," she said. "Bingo, have you ever been to Monte Carlo?" Bingo couldn't help wincing a little at this. Unwittingly, the woman had touched an exposed nerve. The thing he'd always wanted to do most in the world was to go to Monte Carlo, for he had a system which couldn't fail to clean out the casino. But few places, as you are probably aware, are more difficult for a married man to sneak off to.
"No," he said with a touch of moodiness, then recovering his usual sunny aplomb. "Look," he said, "watch old partner in sickness and in health. I place the umbrella so, then maintaining a perfect equilibrium..."
"I want you to go there at once," said Mrs. Bingo. Bingo dropped the umbrella. You could have knocked him down with a toothpick. For a moment, he tells me, he thought that he must be dreaming some beautiful dream. "It's for my book. I can't get on without some local colour."
Bingo grasped the gist.
Mrs. Bingo had often discussed this business of local colour with him. Nowadays, he knew, if you are providing wholesome fiction for the masses, you've simply got to get your atmosphere right. The customers have become cagey. They know too much. Chance your arm with the mise-en-scene, and before you can say, "What ho," you've made some bloomer, and people are writing you nasty letters, beginning, "Dear madam, are you aware?" "And I can't go myself. There's the pen and ink dinner on Friday, and on Tuesday the Writers' Club is giving a luncheon to Mrs. Carrie Melrose Bopp, the American novelist. And any moment now I shall be coming..."
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.